All right, today is May 30th, 2022. My name is Sonia He with the Houston Asian American Archive, and today I am with Dr. Khawaja Azimuddin, who will be speaking about his oral history. Thank you so much for joining me today, Khawaja.
Thank you very much for the invitation, Sonia. It's a pleasure to be here.
All right, so then I guess we'll go ahead and get started. My first question is, could you talk about when and where were you born?
I was born in Bangladesh. At that time, Bangladesh was called East Pakistan. So this was before 1971, when Bangladesh got its independence. So I was born in the pre-independence area time of Bangladesh, when it was still part of Pakistan in the 60s.
All right. And then could you talk about the household that you grew up in?
We were a family of five, the three children and my parents. My parents were both educated. My father was a bachelor in commerce, and he was employed as an assistant manager in mill number three at the Adamji Jute Mills. In those days, jute was a big deal. Before the advent of polythene and polypropylene, jute was a big thing, and it was made into sacks, something to cover or bind things, and it was kind of used everywhere. So jute was a big thing. Adamji Jute Mills was one of the biggest jute mills in the world at that time. And that is where I was born, in Bangladesh at the Adamji Jute Mills. My mother was a teacher. She was a BS in home economics, and she taught in the elementary school. I was privileged to be one of her students as well. And the two of us moved from India at the time, just after the partition of India. You probably heard about 1947 partition of India. And at that time, my father and mother decided to move to East Pakistan. They had three children. My brother was the oldest. He was a very good student, unlike me. My sister was 2 years older than I, and I was the youngest of the three. So we lived pretty good life. We lived in a nice bungalow provided by the Jute Mills company. We all lived in the community, in the residential complex of the Jute Mills. So we lived at that time in Adamji Jute Mills in one of the staff bungalows. And, we had a very good life, and everything was going very smoothly for my father and my family. And things were looking upbeat and great in the late 60s.
All right. And then you said you lived in this community provided by the company. Were there other kids around your age? What was the neighborhood like? Did you play some games that you could describe for us?
Yes, it was a huge big community, actually. But we kind of lived in an area where there was some segregation. So we used to go out and play a little bit, but there was not a whole lot of that going on. My parents were very protective. I guess my mother was very protective, and she wanted us to stay home, study and stuff like that. And in my earliest memories of the childhood, there was already some trouble starting to brew in East Pakistan at that time. So my mother was kind of a little hesitant about sending us out. So it was mostly we stayed home, and all our games and activities were within the home. I had some pet pigeons and chickens, and I used to go out in the yard and play with them. And I guess that was my entertainment at that time.
All right. And what were some of the values your parents brought you and your siblings up with?
Yeah. Well, my mother was a teacher. And to her, the most important thing was to get a good education. So, of course, all parents teach, respect of the elderly and, home values and being part of the family. And, of course, those were there. But one of the main predominant emphasis in her life was to get us educated. And she wanted us to be very, very good, and be good students. And my brother was older than I am, so she was able to work very hard, and he got to become a very good student, but I was still only in third grade. So, you know, though she was still working on it, I was probably not showing any bright prospects at that time. I was only in third grade, but my sister and brother were already very good students, and that was her main emphasis.
Okay, yeah, that's definitely something I can relate to. My parents also definitely emphasized education for me.
Yeah, for her, education was the most important thing, and she wanted us to be very well educated and, get good education.
Mm-hmm. Were you raised on any spiritual systems or belief systems?
So we are Muslims.
Mm-hmm.
And the religion was a big part of growing up, and belief in God and that God will take care of you was one of the most important things that was prevalent in our household. My mother was more religiously inclined than my father was, but both of them did instill in us the value of believing in God, and also to kind of say that, whatever happens, it's for a good reason, and God has a test for you, and you have to be steadfast and keep on the right path.
Okay. And you kind of were alluding to this before, but you've been talking about some conflicts and some tensions in then East Pakistan, now Bangladesh. Could you kind of talk about that, and what were the results on you and your family?
So, Pakistan in those days consisted of East and West Pakistan. And believe it or not, this was a country that had two parts, each separated by almost 1,000 miles. And it's kind of almost incomprehensible how that is possible. So yes, when India was partitioned in 1947, they divided it into East, the areas of Muslim majority became Pakistan, and the areas of Hindu majority became India. It just so happens that the two areas of Muslim majority were in the east and west corners of the subcontinent. So when they decided to form the new country, which they named Pakistan, one part was in the west and the other part was in the east, separated by 1,000 miles of distance. So now, of course, you can imagine then if you have 1,000 miles of geographical distance between the two, there is obviously going to be differences in the culture, in the language, in the values, and everything in life. There were differences. The only uniting factor was the religion, which was the common binding source. But ethnically, they were different people. And their cultures were different, their values were different, their entertainment was different, everything was different. So there was, of course, a difference of opinion. And over a period of time, this difference of opinion started growing more. The East Pakistanis felt that the West Pakistanis were not treating them appropriately or equally. And they had a feeling that there was they were being treated as the inferior partner. Because the language, for example, was imposed on them. They spoke Bengali, and they were told, hey, from today, the national language of Pakistan is Urdu, so you must speak Urdu. So that was not acceptable. It won't be acceptable to anybody. So over a period of time, tensions rose because of a variety of reasons, and most importantly, because they felt that they were not being treated equally. So they started raising their voice, and then the West Pakistanis took some actions, which were unfortunate, and tensions started growing. And to the extent that when the elections happened in 1971, the Bengali party from East Pakistan clearly won the elections, but they were denied the right to form the government. So instead, the West Pakistanis wanted to form their own government. And that, of course, was a no-no. And the Bengalis at that time revolted and they declared a war. And as things started going south, the whole country was embroiled in a civil war, which lasted for about a year or so. As it happens in civil wars, you know, there is no limit. People start transgressing the limits and start fighting about everything, and innocent people are killed. And a lot of people are kind of, they just become part of this big scene. And unfortunately, my family was also caught in this turmoil. Though we did not have any political affiliations, we did not have any aspirations, we did not have any specific agenda. My father was just a mill manager, my mother was just a teacher. We were just not involved in any politics, but still we were the wrong kind of people. And by that, what I mean, we were not Bengalis. And the predominantly Bengali population of the East Pakistan felt that all the foreigners are the source of troubles. And our family was included in the definition of all the foreigners. And unfortunately, we got caught up in that civil war.
I'm sorry to hear that. Yeah, it does seem like with the current war going on, there's a lot of ways that innocent people are wrapped up into conflicts.
Yeah, unfortunately, that's what happens in most places, that it is the innocent people who often get caught.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned in some of the information that you sent over that you were both a refugee and a civilian prisoner of war. Could you talk a little bit about your experience as a civilian prisoner of war? What does that mean? And,
okay. Yeah. So, what happened is that when the situation got out of hand, there was a war between India and Pakistan. The Bengalis got their independence, and suddenly we found ourselves unwanted citizens of the new country, that is Bangladesh. Even though I was born there, I was raised there, I was still became a foreigner with no place or no nationality. So we went into the refugee camps at that time. We went by our own choice to the refugee camps because the alternative was even worse. That alternative was getting killed during the mayhem. So we sought protection in refugee camps that were run by the United Nations. And the UNHCR did a wonderful, amazing job. And they put us in these housings and they fed us, they gave us food and they looked after us. They gave us warm clothing and they gave us food and medical support. And this refugee camp was in the outskirts of Dhaka, in the current Bangladesh. Now, the next question came as what would be done with about these? There were 93,000 people in those camps and in the surrounding areas. There were many different camps spread across East Pakistan. The next question came, what to do with these 93,000 people? You cannot just let them go into the streets because they would be killed. You cannot keep them indefinitely in the camps. The next option was to send them back to West Pakistan. Now, remember, West Pakistan was 1,000 miles apart. It was not just simple to put 93,000 people and put them in airplanes or whatever and just transfer them across. The other problem came because there were no communications in those days. There were no diplomatic channels. So what the Indians did is to save us from absolute mayhem. They said, okay, we will transfer them to West Pakistan, but in the interim, we'll put them in trains and go westward and towards West Pakistan, and then we'll put them in camps. So 93,000 people were evacuated out of these camps in Bangladesh, in the newly formed country of Bangladesh, and they were transported to India. And in India, they made makeshift camps and they put us in these camps. And these were the camps that were, we stayed there for a couple of years. Now, the reason why that happened is because, as I mentioned, there were no diplomatic channels between India and Pakistan. They were warring countries and they didn't want to speak with each other. So our case became a limbo situation. So while the world was moving around us, we didn't see any movement and we didn't see any hope that we would be released. So day in, day after, we were languishing in the camps, and we just did not have a clear-cut idea as when we would be going back to Pakistan. So that is why it took us almost 2 years to get from East Pakistan to West Pakistan. In these 2 years, we spent in the camps in India. Now, in the camps, there were, as I mentioned, there were 93,000 people. Some of them were military personnel. Some of them were civilians like us. So United Nations gave my family a CUPC, Civilians Under Protective Custody registration number. And we became refugees amongst those prisoner of wars. They housed us in different camps than those where the military POWs. And we were fed and clothed for the next 2 years. These were hard times, and we had, quite a bit of difficult circumstances over the next 2 years before we were repatriated back to Pakistan.
And how old were you during all this?
So I was 8 years old when I went into the camp. And when I got out of the camp, I was 10 years old. So we spent 2 years there, and as an eight-year-old child, you can probably run around and just cry and laugh and do whatever needs to be done. You had asked about the experience of the refugee camp. I personally, was very much shielded and protected by my family. So as a child is a child, and I didn't have such a traumatic experience. But of course, the older people and my mother and father, they went through a whole lot. They were living a life of, a good life. And suddenly they were put into this camp with very little access to anything in life, anything in civilized life. And these were some very, very harsh experiences for them. As a child, you really don't care. But my parents did went through a whole lot, and they really suffered, and it wasn't easy living in the camps in those circumstances. I still remember that.
Mm-hmm. Did your parents or did your older siblings talk to you about their experiences as you got older?
Yes. So my parents didn't so much want to talk about it. When we queried them, they would answer, but they were kind of traumatized, and because they were so traumatized with this, they did not want to dwell into it too much, okay? But my siblings did, and especially when I started writing the book, I consulted with my siblings, and they were older than I was, so they remembered more about the events surrounding the whole deal. And they gave me a whole lot of information that I did not remember. Of course, I was 8 to 10 years old, so there is only so much I can remember. But my siblings gave me a whole lot of information of our times. And then I wrote up some stuff, and I consulted with my mother and got her opinion about it. So she helped me a little bit as well. But I'm indebted to my siblings who gave me a lot of information on what transpired.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm sure being a pretty traumatic experience, not a lot of people in general would want to talk about it.
They don't want to talk about it, yes.
Mm-hmm. All right, I guess I can move forward a little bit. You said you eventually arrived in Pakistan when you were 10. How long did your family take to settle down in Pakistan? Did y'all stay there until, how long?
Yes, it was difficult times in Pakistan because once we arrived in Pakistan, we didn't have really have a place to live, and my father didn't have a job. My father would went out every morning in search of a job, and he just could not find one. It took almost a year before my father found a job. So in the meantime, what we did is we found some relatives and we stayed in their homes maybe for a few months here and a few months there. Unfortunately, in those days, there were not much support services. Like, for example, now here in Texas, we have the Texas Refugee Commission Alliance, the AMANA Refugee Services. These are refugee support organizations. There was no concept at that time. So my family really had a very tough time. Food was scarce, clothing was scarce, and we lived kind of hand-to-mouth with some distant family members. And when we worn out the welcome, we went to another place. So that lasted for a year. My father finally got a job, but still it was a very meager income considering his qualifications. He just took the first job that he could find. And economics were bad at that time, so it was difficult to find a job. And he just took whatever came in. So it was difficult times. We lived very much hand to mouth. And it was almost like 3-4 years, like 3 to 4 years when my family started stabilizing a little bit. I mean, before we were eating like bread with water and stuff like that. At least after like 3-4 years or so, we could afford something more than that. The human thing that stands out in all of this is that we did have some family members and friends of my father who actually offered some monetary support to my father, which I'm not sure if he took that, but he was a very, you know, a man of honor, and he didn't want to get any help from anyone. I don't really know whether he took some money from the friends, but the human kindness that stands out is that there were still some people who offered some support to my father during those times. In about like 7-8 years, my father got a better job and he moved to the Middle East. So now money was no longer a problem. By that time, I was also in the medical school. Now in Pakistan, education was free in those days. Otherwise, we could never have even dreamt of going to school. So the college was free, the school was free, then the college was free. And then the medical school fee was barely like, you know, a couple of $100, not even that. So we were able to afford that because by this time my father was already employed in the Middle East, and I spent the next 6 years in the medical school. In 1989, I had finished my medical school, graduated, and then for higher education, I went over to the United Kingdom to do my further training. And then in 1995, I moved over to America to pursue even further training. You probably remember I just said earlier, my mother had emphasized higher education, not just education, higher. So that was the instinct that was instilled in us, is to get more and more higher education. And in order to get even further education, I decided to move to United States in 1995. And I've been in New York, Pennsylvania, New Mexico, and finally here in Houston since 2005.
Okay, wow. Yeah, definitely a lot of educational experience. And I guess it's a very good thing that at that time, the education was free for high school and college. And
yes.
Very cheap for medical school. Is medical school in Pakistan like it is in the US, where you have to do your bachelor's first before going into medical school? Or can you jump straight to medical school after high school?
It's a different system. You do your matriculation, which is until 10th grade. And after matriculation, you do 2 years of higher secondary, well, it's called higher secondary education, which is really a college. So only 2 years of college. And then you go into medical school. And medical school in Pakistan is 5 years instead of 4 years. So I guess here in America, we do 4 years of undergraduate, and 4 years of school, medical school. And there in Pakistan, you do 2 years of undergraduate, but 5 years of medical school.
Okay. What made you interested in going to medical school and pursuing medicine?
My mother told me to do so. That's about it. She was very determined that she wanted all her children to be very well educated. So she, even in the camps, she would tell me that I'm going to be a doctor. She told my brother that he is going to be an engineer. And she told my sister that she's going to be a major in home economics. So that was the things I guess girls did in those days. So we all stick to her plan.
Yes. Okay. Very, very dedicated. And so in medical school, could you talk about kind of the experience that you had? Did you like medicine? Did you come to like it? You talk about that a little bit.
I think they say mama knows best, huh? So that must hold true here. So I didn't know much about medicine, or I really did not didn't know what I wanted to be. She just kind of guided me and she said, you're going to be in medical school. And so I got admission in the medical school. And once I got there, I just loved it. It was love at first sight. So I can't ever imagine myself doing anything else in the world than doing medicine. Now, when I went to medical school, I think over a period of time, you kind of know yourself, how things are going and what is your nature. So I was kind of, I had probably a type A personality, some pathological type A personality. So I wanted things to be done quickly. So I kind of gravitated towards surgery. And I loved it. You know, I am still loving it. And if you ask me, there are many, many wonderful things in life. And I am blessed to do a lot of things in life. One passion is family. Another passion is arts and tiles. But my first and foremost passion is surgery. And I really love it when I'm doing surgery. It's something that I feel I was born to do, and it really gives me great pleasure to do something as unique as surgery.
Mm. Yeah, I'm actually also interested in medicine and interested in surgery. So
great, wonderful.
Hopefully,
In my opinion, there is not a better vocation. There is not a better calling. It is not only just serving humanity, but also doing something good. And at the end of the day, you feel good. You know, when I go, I do something and the patient does well, there is so much inner, peace. And, I feel so wonderful. So if you want to be selfish, you can say, well, I do it for my own good. And it just makes me so feel so happy that I've contributed positively to somebody. And it is there to show. You can see the results immediately. And medicine is medicine. You give a drug and it takes a few weeks or months. In surgery, you can get an immediate gratification. You just see the results within a few days or a few weeks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's definitely something that also appeals to me.
Yeah.
I guess moving on to your kind of career path, you mentioned that after medical school, you went to the UK for further training. Would this be the equivalent of like residency or a fellowship in the UK?
Yes, it was the equivalent of a residency training program. The British system is a little different than the American system, and they have 4 years or 5 years of training. You have to take the exams during that period of time, and that exam is called the Fellowship of the Royal Colleges of Surgeons. So I did two fellowships. I did Fellowship of the Royal Colleges of England, as well as Glasgow. So these are very prestigious institutions, and you get a fellowship from them and you become certified as a surgeon. Once I did that, I wanted to get further training and education in surgery. That's when I decided to come to America.
Okay. What made you decide to go to the UK for fellowship?
That was the thing to do in those days. When I graduated from my medical school in Pakistan in 1989, most people for further surgical training used to go to United Kingdom, not to America. So, I just did the thing that everybody else was doing. I said, well, let's go to UK and get some education. And afterwards, when I completed that, I said, what's next? I just didn't think I was ready to start a job now. I said, well, we need to do a little bit more training. So I said, let's go to America.
And then when you came to America, was that when you decided to subspecialize or?
Yes, of course, after I came to America, I completed the residency training program here. But I felt that, if you're super specialized and then I think you have more command on your field. I think there is always room for specialization. And I think specialization does lead to better outcomes. Your patients do better if you are a specialist surgeon. So I chose the field of colon and rectal surgery, not only because it's a very fine surgery, there are great operations, but also, you can make real difference in people's lives. And colon and rectal surgery is one of those, you can operate on a cancer and you can cure a patient. Or there are many other diseases that you can surgically cure the patient. So, I think it was something that appealed to me.
Yeah. Okay. So you did your residency first in the US again. Was that in New York, you said?
That is correct. I went to New York. I landed in a residency training program in New York City in the Bronx. And once I completed that, I did a fellowship in colorectal surgery in Pennsylvania. That was Lehigh Valley Hospital in Pennsylvania. I did my surgical fellowship in the subspecialty of colorectal surgery. So what that means is colorectal problems like cancer of the colon, diverticulitis, ulcerative colitis, and then other rectal problems such as hemorrhoids, prolapse, fistulas, abscesses, and all those things. Patients are very miserable and we can relieve some misery there and improve their quality of life.
Mm-hmm. Did you decide to, did you want to stay in the Northeast in New York and Pennsylvania, or did you want to go explore? Where did you go for your first job, I guess?
The first job was actually not by choice, but I had to do it. And that was to pay my dues to the American society. When a medical doctor comes from abroad, after completing their education, they have a choice to do a 5-year stint in an underserved area in United States. So, there was an opportunity in New Mexico where there was a large underserved community where I could take my expertise and treat the local populations. So I worked there for 5 years. And by virtue of providing my services to the underserved community in the USA, I was awarded a green card. That is the usual process for physicians. Once I was awarded the green card and citizenship, now the question is, where do we go from there? So at that time, I started looking for jobs outside of New Mexico in other areas of America. And it so happened that we got two jobs. One was in Chicago. And my brother lived in Chicago at that time. So we could certainly have gone there and lived there. But my wife's sister lived in Houston. So you know how that goes. We came to Houston.
Of course. Got to listen to the wife.
Of course. Yes, you have to. So that is why I came to Houston. And since I came, I'm loving it. I think I'm kind of a person who starts loving his whatever I got. So when I came to medicine, I started loving it. I came to Houston, I'm loving it. I tell you, there is no city in the world like Houston. This is the most cosmopolitan, diverse city. There's such a lot happening in Houston in all spheres. You know, you name it, and the stuff is happening here, from food to sports to activities to entertainments to medical advancement. Everything is right here in Houston. So I love Houston.
Mm-hmm. Kind of going back a little bit, can you tell me how you met your wife?
This was in Pakistan. I met her after I finished my medical school. I met her and, you know, we clicked and our families clicked and we said, okay, great. We are getting married.
Wow. How long did that take? When did you meet her? When did you all get married?
Probably about a few months, 6 to 8 months probably.
Okay. And did she move to the UK with you? Or you?
She did move to my UK. I was still kind of a resident at that time, a surgical trainee at that time. She moved with me to UK and we had a little girl in 92. She's no longer little now. She's married. She's even have a young baby. So we were blessed to have a baby at that time. And then 96, we had I had a son. And I am blessed that both my kids are in the medical profession. So they both like, we didn't force them, but they decided by choice that is what they want to do. They felt that this was a noble profession. They saw me working in medicine and I think they must have liked it. So they both in medical field.
Very nice. And is your wife also in the medical field? Or?
No, she is not. No, she's the only sane person in the house. And she is not in the medical field.
Yeah. All right. Yes. That is quite the sentiment going to medicine.
Yes.
But very nice. Okay. And so you said you came to Houston in 2005. Is that correct?
Sorry, say that again.
Did you come to Houston in 2005? Was that?
That is correct. Yes.
And did you end up working for one of the large hospital systems or a private practice? Where did you end up?
I started my own private practice in 2005, and over the years, you know, my practice grew and I was able to hire other physicians, and now they are partners. So we are three doctors strong now, and we are all in private practice. We work up here in North Houston area. We work at the Houston Methodist Willowbrook Hospital. That's where I work, and that's where I'm also the chief of medical staff there at that facility.
Okay. What made you want to go into private practice versus working in a safe hospital system?
Yeah, that was a good question. That is a good question. I'm not quite sure why. I think in those days, the trend was more to have private practice. I think nowadays, as new graduates come out, they are more and more inclined to get employed by a hospital or a medical system. But I guess in those days, that was the, you know, routine thing to do. And I just decided to start my own company. And thank God it went very easy and I didn't have any problems and everything settled down in place quite easily. So no regrets. I think I had a fun time starting this company and growing over the period of years.
Okay. I was going to ask, what was the hardest part about opening a private practice? Like, is it recruiting patients? Is it coordinating with insurance? What would you say is the biggest?
Now you got me started. dealing with insurances is the worst part. You know, these days, every little thing, we have to apply for authorization, pre-authorization, pre-certification. So the patient part is usually very good. Patients are usually very nice. They're great people to work with, and they have, you know, they are in trouble. They need somebody to hold their hands. And we do that, and they leave very, very happy. The hospitals and nursing staff are wonderful. Of course, their main aim is to get the patients better and healed as well. It is the insurances that are a big problem. And I'll be very honest, in my opinion, you know, the insurance system has let the American public down. I'm not going to hold back any words, but you know, that's how it is, that every little thing, the doctors don't get paid, the patients end up paying out of their pockets, and there is so much we can go after a patient. But even once we've provided a service, even an emergency service, they would sometimes come back and deny that this was not an emergency. So try to explain that to your loved one, or, you know, that you are in a big debt now because your case was not an emergency in the dictionary of an administrator in the insurance company who was just sitting on the computer and, you know, following the clicks. So I think, unfortunately, you know, there is a lot of profit to be made in insurance industry, and that is what they are going after.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's definitely something that we hear a lot in the news about people going.
I think it's a sad situation in the United States here, the way the insurance companies treat, you know, the patients and the doctors in the hospitals. It is indeed a sad situation. And fortunately, one day we will have a better healthcare system in America. And let me tell you another sad situation about medicine in America is that there are so many patients who do not have insurance, and they really get, you know, hamstrung. They go through so much trouble. Every month I see at least two or three patients who have severe illnesses such as cancer, and we cannot treat them. Even if I offered my services free of cost to them, you know, still they cannot do their surgery or get chemotherapy because all these things cost a lot of money. And there is no way a normal American citizen can afford the cost of healthcare. There is no way they can afford that. So, these poor people, they have to live now with the with this understanding. Hey, I have a cancer; it's spreading inside my belly, and there is nothing I can do about it. So this is a sad state that here in America, the richest country in the world and the best country in the world, we cannot take care of our people who have this kind of, for example, a cancer. So this is a very, very, very sad situation that we just have to say, sorry, I can't help you. Even if I give my services free, they still cannot afford to have the operation because healthcare is so, so much expensive in the United States. Mm-hmm. So I hope one day there will be a system where people can actually get healthcare and they do not have to deal with the craziness in the insurance industry, because insurance industry is a business, yeah? And they're looking for profit. So that is the big problem that I have with healthcare in America, is that the insurance companies have jacked up the prices so much, or they do not provide benefits to the patients. And then even if some patients have insurances, their deductibles or co-pays may be so, so high that they still cannot afford to have the surgery, even with an insurance. And then there is another group that just does not have insurance. and they are the ones who are just left them out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm curious, since you've had experience in Pakistan and in the UK, how does the insurance system and healthcare system work differently there to give
everybody? So I have very good experience in UK. I did not practice much in Pakistan, but I can tell you in the UK, they have the National Health Insurance, NIH. And what that means is that everybody who is a citizen is covered by some kind of a insurance, okay? Now, it's not free. People pay it in their taxes. And also sometimes they have to pay out of pocket, but at least they get care. Now, what happens in England is that the healthcare is rationed, if you want to use that word. Rationing, sometimes people think that is a bad word. Rationing can be a good word. It does not have to be necessarily bad. What, for example, the rationing means, I can give you an example, that if you have pain in your knee joint, and only 50 MRIs are going to be performed today, then you will probably have to wait for a week or so to get your MRI. And there is really nothing wrong with that. If you're talking about knee pain versus somebody dying from cancer, I would wait for a week. I mean, and it's not that you have broken your knee or something. In England, if you broke your knee, you're obviously going to get that scan today. But if it is a chronic pain, you've been living with this pain for 2 years, and now suddenly it is not an emergency, okay? So this is what we get, you know, I have a headache and I want an MRI today. You ask them, how long have you had the headache? It's been 2 years since I've had the headache. Now it just does not become an emergency that you need to get the MRI of the head or the CT scan of the head today. So that is what rationing is. It's really not necessarily a bad word. So in UK, you may have to, for example, if you need a hernia operation, which is a non-emergency, you may have to wait a month or 2 months to get the operation done. In America, you can get the operation done tomorrow. So I think when we look at overall health of a nation, I think it is more important to prioritize a patient dying with cancer or a child dying with an acute disease or your parents dying of a serious disease and they cannot afford to have the surgery done. You have to prioritize that versus a non-acute chronic ache or pain in the back. So yes, if you want everything for yourself and even mild pain in the finger, you want the treatment today. Yes, you are entitled to that, but what about the other people who are suffering and dying from cancer? By the way, even in England, if you have a lot of money and if you don't want to be in the line, you can actually go and pay for yourself and get the MRI done tomorrow. So it's not that you have to go through the NIH. Yes, if you are super rich, you can definitely still pay out of your pocket and get that MRI done tomorrow. But for regular people, I don't think waiting for a week or 10 days in the line is really a big deal. I think we have to think of our nation as a whole and prioritize the health of the nation. Unfortunately, far too many people go without vaccination and other preventive healthcare or even emergency healthcare because of lack of insurance and lack of money. So I think, I personally feel, and I have no shame in saying that we have to think about the health of the nation. Yes, it is fine if you want the MRI or CAT scan done yesterday, that is fine. That's your prerogative. You can pay to get it done. But what about the thousands of people who are dying? I cannot tell you how sad it makes me when I'm holding the hand of a cancer patient. and tell him that, sorry, I cannot do anything for you because you do not have money and you do not have insurance. You have to go to the charity hospital, and the charity hospitals, it takes months to get in there, and a lot of patients will just, you know, succumb to their disease while waiting for that care to happen.
Yeah, your comments about thinking about the overall health of the nation really ring true, I feel like, during the pandemic. And people asking to be putting on their masks when they go outside, asking them to get vaccines. And then there's a lot of pushback against both of these things.
Yeah.
I guess kind of talking about your involvement in Houston, could you talk a little bit about any of your local involvements with the local community?
So in Houston, I've been involved with the Islamic Arts Society. This is a society that I started a few years ago. I'm an artist as well, and you may have seen some of my art. I make some big scale murals and stuff like that. I do ceramic art. And being an artist myself, I felt that there were a lot of people who were interested in my art. And this is what we call Islamic art. Now, there is Christian art, there is Jewish art, and there is something called Islamic art. If you go to Metropolitan Museum or any other museum in the world, you will find a section of Islamic art. And to basically define Islamic art, it is mostly calligraphy, arabesque, geometric patterns, and stuff like that. So when I displayed my art, I felt that a lot of people were intrigued by this art. What is this Islamic art? And I decided to start a show or an exhibition of Islamic art. I gathered some artists, and then we started a festival. And this festival is held every year. We started in 2014, and by the grace of God, it is now the largest festival of Islamic arts, largest and oldest festival of Islamic arts in North America. During this festival, we invite artists, and there are usually about 40 to 50 artists who come and display their art. And this is all Islamic art. This is not contemporary. A lot of people come to the festival. Thousands of people come to the festival. And during the two-day festival, they actually see the pieces of Islamic art, they enjoy it, and they're inquisitive, they ask about it. A lot of Muslims come to the festival, and a lot of non-Muslims come to the festival. So it is my great pleasure that we welcome Christians, Jews, Hindus, Sikhs, and people of all denominations, and people who don't believe in God. We bring them and show them the pieces of Islamic art, and they start understanding the values of Islamic art, or what is the concept behind Islamic art, and they appreciate it. Art is something that kind of opens up people, and they let their guards down and they start talking. And we found that when non-Muslims come to our festival, they are very inquisitive, they inquire about it, and they usually leave a very friendly, neighborly impression about our community. So we kind of realized that, hey, this is a good way of bringing people together. Maybe the Christians, the Jews, the Hindus, and Muslims, we can all get together and talk about over a piece of art and enjoy it. So that started really the Islamic Art Society, and our mission statement is to reach out to everyone in Houston and introduce them to Islamic art. They will start talking and they will start appreciating each other. And we've actually gone outside of Houston. We've done programs outside of Houston, outside of Texas as well. So the idea, you know, started like that. And we said, hey, why don't we actually, festival is where they come to us. Why don't we go out to everyone? So we started doing library programs, colleges, schools, universities. So what we do is, you know, go out and do an art exhibition of Islamic art, maybe do a workshop. of Islamic art and just open up the dialogue. And people enjoy that. There's a lot of questions they come up with. Why is it like this? What is Islamic art? What are you trying to portray here? So we feel that opens up a communication channel between different diverse groups of people. So we've been very successful. Only in the last few months, we've done an Islamic Arts Day at the Museum of Fine Arts in Houston. A couple of months ago, we went to Sam Houston University in Huntsville and did a program on Islamic arts, very well attended by the students there. We did a recent program at Asia Society. We've been to some schools recently. And we've been to some festivals. And overall, I think that what our stalls do and what our volunteers do in these events is get people talking. They kind of start appreciating each other. They start valuing each other's traditions. And just it's a wonderful feeling to be able to bring these diverse groups together for a fun event. So that's what we are doing in Houston.
Yeah, that's a really cool mission. I feel like bringing the community, different communities together is a really important part.
And I think, you know, part of it is that we just talked a little bit about it is kind of from my childhood experience. When, you know, you mentioned that was I going out to play with a lot of kids? I think even in those days, the problems were brewing and people were not talking to each other. The East Pakistanis and West Pakistanis were not talking to each other. And I think people were living in their shells and following their way of life and not appreciating or understanding the other person. And I think that message stuck to me. And I think that's probably been a very big factor in me and you know, trying to do this work is, hey, why not let's get people talking together? And with that really in mind, I think this, the goal of this society, the Islamic Arts Society, is wonderful. We are bringing people together. We are it's unfortunately COVID has done another bad thing, is we've put people in their closets or in their shells a little bit more. And I think as we are coming out of COVID, I think it's a good opportunity to kind of mingle with each other, trying to learn from each other, trying to learn each other's values and traditions and respect them for what they are. So I think the Islamic Arts Society is doing a wonderful job in bringing people together. You can check us out on social media, Instagram, Facebook, and on our website as well. The website is www.islamicartssociety.org. So islamicartssociety.org. You can check it out.
I definitely will after this interview. Thank you so much for sharing that. I'm curious though, what made you interested in art? What got you into ceramic tile? What prompted you? Mm-hmm.
You know, when I lived in New Mexico, I saw some nice art, some ceramic tiles. And I felt that, you know, this is such a beautiful creation. Around Santa Fe, there is a big artsy community. And I felt that this was something, you know, beautiful. And I made friends with a gentleman, his name was Benjamin, and he was doing some ceramic art tiles. So I kind of asked him and learned from him and started doing a couple of tiles myself. And this was 2001, many years ago. And over the years, I have been able to do more and more. And, you know, it's such a pleasure to create something of beauty. And you put it on the wall or you put it on the table and it just looks nice and beautiful. I have been fortunate enough to do some large scale murals as well in community spaces. And when I go there, you know, it's just a good feeling that, hey, I made this place beautiful. And when some people find out that, oh, you made this, so they are kind of surprised. So it gives me a good feeling that I contributed to the beauty of this place. It gives, so looking at my finished product, It gives me a great pleasure and sense of achievement, but also the process of making or creating the ceramic tiles is also very, very amazingly nice and interesting. It's soothing, it's calming, because I would sit in my room and just start painting. It's a very long process, takes hours, but it's a very peaceful few hours. I would turn some background music, sit down and relax and just do some painting on tiles.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Would you say that art is a way for you to cope with the stress of your work life in medicine? Is it a way to prevent burnout for you?
Yes, I think the first and foremost thing is my family. I love coming back to home and enjoying the time with my family. But I also know that on many occasions I've come back from a long, tiring, 14, 15 hours a day. I come back home at 10 o'clock at night, and by 10:30 I'm sitting in my table and painting. Maybe just for 10, 15 minutes on a day like that, but at least I'm kind of winding down and relaxing. It's really a very soothing feeling, relaxing and calming feeling to do that.
Mm. All right. And I guess we'll move on to kind of relevant topics about the current events. And the first thing that comes to mind is about the pandemic, COVID-19. Can you kind of talk about how the pandemic has affected your life for the past 2 years and your business as a private practice?
So I was very fortunate that none of the members of my immediate family were affected with COVID. Of course, I was going to work almost every day, even throughout the pandemic, and I took care of lots and lots of patients with COVID. But I was fortunate enough that with proper protection, masks and other protective equipment, I did not die. I'm so grateful for that. The pandemic affected a whole lot of things and a whole lot of people's lives. And it was sad to see some people die of the disease just because they did not believe in vaccination and stuff like that. Prevention is always better than cure. And especially with the last, I feel with all the spikes and months of COVID devastation, I think the worst period was the Delta pandemic that came, a few months ago. And it was depressing because that is when we saw people who were young and healthy. They just did not believe in vaccination, and many of my patients died, young, healthy patients, fathers, sons, they passed away because of the pandemic, just because they didn't believe in the vaccines. So that was depressing. That was actually the most depressing period in the last 2 years, not the initial part. You asked how it affected my practice. That was, the practice got slow to begin with for the first 6 months or 8 months. There were not all the elective surgeries were canceled because we didn't want patients to be exposed by coming into the hospital. So we canceled all the elective surgeries we just waited on them. So the practice was very slow for the first 6 months or so. And after that, things started picking up a little bit. Now we are back to full-fledged working and very busy in Houston.
Very nice. Did your practice utilize telemedicine when COVID first hit, or did you still see patients in clinic?
Sorry, I did not hear that question.
Yes. Did your practice start using telemedicine when the pandemic first hit, or did
we did do some telemedicine? Yes, we did some conference call with the patients, virtual appointments. Yes, but now we are back to normal. Yeah.
Okay. What do you see the impact of technology having on medicine. I know in one of the forms you filled out for me, some of the information you sent out, you talked about robotics in medicine and winning an award for that. Can you talk about that, robots in medicine, and then just technology in general in medicine?
Yes, so technology has come a long way, and I am amazed that in my lifetime all this has happened. And, you know, I feel privileged to be working in this day and age. One good thing that has happened is the information is available. So information, we can get all kinds of information. We can access the patient's chart sitting at home. So, you know, in the middle of the night, there is an emergency. I can actually access the patient's chart, x-rays and all that, look at the images myself. And that is because of the electronic medical records that has come up. A few years ago, there was a lot of skepticism about this and people didn't want to move away from paper charts. But, you know, it's really a no-brainer. Technology has revolutionized the care of patients. Nowadays, we even have like iPads in the hospital, and you know, the nurse can take the iPad to the patient and we can talk to them in real time while we could be, you know, 50 miles away. So that's one aspect. But the biggest aspect that you just alluded to me in my personal practice, the biggest element is the induction of the robot. Now, here is a robot. It doesn't really look like R2-D2 or anything like that. It is a machine that is actually hooked to the patient. So before starting the surgery, I would hook up that, I would create some access ports and hook that machine to the patient's body. After that, I would go and sit in a console and direct the machine on the patient to do the work. Now you would say, what would be the benefit of that? That you know, the benefit is that I can control that machine to do maneuvers and movements and actions that even I perhaps would not have been able to do. How's that possible? Because the machine actually has a lot of dexterity and it can reach in places where my eyes and my hands cannot reach. So that kind of a very novel idea is that the machine is, the robot is made in such a way that its flexible instruments can actually reach in a place that where my hands cannot reach. So it can perform that surgery deep in that space. So we do a lot of surgeries, and I actually started doing robotic surgeries very early in Houston, 2010. Not many people in Houston were doing robotic surgeries. I got trained at that time and did my first surgery in 2010. Since then, it has grown considerably, and we are doing a whole lot more of robotic surgeries. But, you know, it's one of those things that I think is has really revolutionized the care. We are able to do surgeries much faster, easier, less trauma to the patient, less bleeding, less pain to the patient, faster recovery. There are so many benefits of the robotic surgery that our patients simply do better, and we surgeons simply perform a better surgery. I feel that, you know, I trust my hands, and actually my hands are the ones that is guiding the robot. But I think that the robot does a more precise job. It is being directed by me, but it still reaches spaces and does a precise job. For example, I'll tell you, the vision in the robot is magnified. So my eyes can see so much, but the robot is making me see better because it has magnified the tissue. So I can see the nerves, the blood vessels much better when I'm sitting on the console of the robot. So I think it is really revolutionized. And I would say that for colon and rectal surgery, the hernias, and for many other operations, robot is the best thing that has happened in the last few decades to surgery.
Mm-hmm. Just out of curiosity, are you referring to the Da Vinci machine?
Say that again?
Are you referring to the Da Vinci machine? That's the...
Yes, there are many different types of robotic systems, many, many different types. And one of them is the Da Vinci machine, which we use for abdominal surgery. And this is the Da Vinci machine robot that I personally use in my practice.
Very nice. All right, and I guess we are going to move on to our final set of questions focused on your identity. How would you identify yourself? American or otherwise Asian American? What would you say?
I am American, who is a Muslim and comes from Pakistan. Mm-hmm. So this is my identity, and this is what I have taught my children. This is what I project myself as, and I'm an American Muslim who hails from Pakistan, mm-hmm. who was born in Pakistan.
Yeah. And what would you say would be some of the advice you would give to aspiring physicians like myself, or people who are interested in working in bridging cultures and bridging nations like you are with the Islamic Arts Society?
So my advice to aspiring physicians is, obviously, you've chosen the right field. There's nothing better. There's no better vocation than being a doctor. I cannot think of anything in the world that would bring you as much pleasure and that would let you help so many people who are distressed and in trouble. So I think the first step is already there. You've made an amazing choice. Secondly, it is dedication. Once you are a physician, you cannot really say, hey, I got to do this, I got to leave. There is no such thing as leaving your patient. The patient is yours, and you are the person who's responsible for this life. So be aware of long hours. So long hours can mean that, you can be called in the middle of the night. You have to go during the weekend. And also, a patient is always in your mind. He never leaves your mind. So whenever, whether you're at home eating with your family or something, you're still, the patient is in the back of your mind. You have to worry about it. And that's the only way you can provide good service to the patient. So patient is first and foremost. If you had to cancel your vacation, you cancel your vacation. So that requires a lot of dedication, and you really can't do it if you don't have the passion to do it. So if you, there's no way you can look for a shortcut in medicine. Things will happen and you just have to give your whole 100% to the patient. I am so blessed that I have a wife who understands this, and she lets me do what needs to be done for a patient. So if I ever leave 11 p.m. or midnight, she's fine with that. And if I am late for something, which I actually I can count on my fingers of my hand how many times I've not made it to an appointment with my family. But if that ever happens, she understands that as well. So this is a big commitment. It's in a way, it's a way of life. You just cannot say, no, I will take care of you later, I have to go somewhere. You just cannot do that. So you have to be passionate about providing service to your patient, because after all, this patient's life depends and rests in your hand. So, and then I also want to tell you that the super specialization in the field, I believe, leads to better outcome. So these things, number one, you have to be dedicated. You have to give yourself, up to the patient and the medical field, and specialize, and then leave the rest in God's hand. So that was my advice to aspiring physicians. Coming back to the second aspect is that my advice to a community as general is that we need to just know each other and respect each other. If we stay away from each other and do not talk to each other, it is just natural that suspicions will grow. And what do these people do? What do these people do there in their house of worship? Why are they doing it like this? So we have to kind of appreciate each and everyone. Everybody has their own values. they have their own thought process, they have their own religion, and we all got to respect each other wherever they are. And it is very easy that sometimes I make presumptions about somebody. And I'll tell you that I've always been wrong about, I make presumption, oh, he's doing it like this because he wants this or doesn't want to do this or, behaving badly or this is not what he means. And I tell you that I've always been wrong in my presumptions. So I think most people can be wrong in their presumptions. So it is best to come out and talk with each other. That is the only way you will know each other. And we feel that art is a wonderful tool to do so. Art is a universal language. Everyone understands something of beauty and they can relate to something of beauty, and people can come together and talk to each other when there is when the topic is art or when they are actually seeing a beautiful item on display. So I think bringing people together through that is a very noble cause, and I would say people should come out more, visit our festival, visit our events, and get to know each other. Maybe we are not that different. Maybe Muslims are not that different. I think all cultures and religions and races and ethnicities, they all teach their children the same thing. Every mother in the world teaches her child to be noble, nice, giving, caring, loving. It's not the other way around.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you so much for your advice on both of these points. And I guess the last thing I wanted to touch on is the book that you kind of hinted at the beginning of this interview. You wrote a book recently about your experiences as a child. Could you kind of talk about what inspired you to write that book, what made you want to write it, and then the process of writing?
Okay, so that's a big question, and I love the question. It was about my experiences, my childhood experiences as a civilian POW, prisoner of war. And I just thought it was a good story to write about. And also, I think the time was ripe. I felt that there was this book would bring attention to the refugee crisis in the world, which it did. I think a lot of people heard or learned about the refugee issues at that time. This is about my story from where the trouble started in East Pakistan to the time when we were picked up by the United Nations and we were put in refugee camps, the 2 years that we sent in the refugee camps, and then our release to Pakistan. So the book is about that 2.5 year period of time of my life. The book I wrote in 2020, it was published, and I'd always had this in the back of my mind that I would one day write up this story, because it was just such an unusual story. My children were intrigued about it. My friends kind of knew about it, but not much. And I just thought it was a good story. But I also felt that it was an opportunity to bring to light the refugee crisis in the world. And many people know this, that at this moment, there are more than 70 million refugees in the world. That's a big number. This is the biggest number of refugees or displaced persons in the history of the world since World War II. So it is a sad state of affair that here we are in the 21st century with all the modern advancement and everything. And we have a situation where so many people are just driven out of their homes because they either speak the wrong language or they have the wrong religion or they have the wrong accent or ethnicity or the race or the skin color. No fault of their own. It's just the way they were born, and that holds out against them, and they are kicked out of their homes. And this is such a sad state of affairs that we live here in the 21st century. So I wanted to bring attention to that fact. You asked about the process of writing the book. The process of writing the book was actually pretty enjoyable for me. I thoroughly enjoyed writing the book. It took me almost 3 years to complete the book and get it published. I would think of stuff and write it down in a Word document and organize it, and then make chapters and write up the initial draft. I did get some book editors to edit my book and give me feedback on both English and the storyline as well. One of the best part about writing the book was the research involved in doing the book. I mentioned that I spoke with my brother and sister, and also got some advice from my mother when she was alive. I needed more information, and I interviewed a lot of people. I also looked up on the internet, and on the internet and in the libraries, there is a huge amount of resource available for this. I'm so happy about this technology revolution, the information age that we live in, that you can find even the minutest detail. So for example, you can find if the moon was full on the night of the 11th of January in 1971. You could even find that kind of information. And of course, there are so many other pieces of information that you can, what was happening outside our camp, what was the world doing, what was the foreign ministers and the ambassadors and the governments were doing. So I found all that information in the book and on the internet. And then I got an opportunity to interview a lot of people who had the same predicament. So I did some research and found some people who were actually in the POW camps along with my family. There were 93,000 people. So, you know, there was still quite a few people alive, and I was able to interview a lot of those people. I even went out and met them personally. I went to Canada as well to meet a couple of people who were in my camp. So, you know, just going out to them, reaching out to them and interviewing these people was a very pleasurable experience. So overall, I think it was a very good and fulfilling experience for me. I really thoroughly enjoyed writing the book, having it corrected, redoing the whole manuscript. It's a long process. And then fortunately, I was able to find a publisher and they published my book. So all in all, it has been a very good experience for me.
That's very nice to hear. I feel like I've run into quite a few physicians who have written a book so far in their lives. So I feel like it might be a doctor thing to do.
It probably is, yes.
All right. And second to last question, if you had to leave a message, like a time capsule, for your great-great-grandchildren or people who find this message in the future, what would you want to say to them?
I think a message would be that stay on the course, stay steadfast. There will always be adversities and ups and downs in life, but you get to carry on your mission and walk with everyone else and take everyone else with you in the journey. Respect everyone for whatever they are. And, you know, I think that they too have their point of view. So everybody has their own point of view, and they are entitled to their point of view as well. So we have to respect each other.
Very nice message. And final question, is there anything else you would like to add that I didn't ask about, or I didn't cover, you didn't cover? Anything else you can think of?
I think the interview was quite exhaustive and covered every aspect. I would encourage the listeners to check out my story And the story is the book, The Boy Refugee, a memoir from a long forgotten war. Check that out in Amazon or Barnes & Noble. And also you can check out the book at theboyrefugee.com, www.theboyrefugee.com. And if you go to that website, you will also see my art pieces. So that's a bonus there, that the art pieces that I have created there, they are there. I am honored and humbled that you have interviewed me for this segment. I wish you best wishes for your future as a physician. And thank you very much for doing the interview.
Thank you so much for having me today.